Anyway, it's really nice to have you here with us, Dr. Ortiz. I'd love to learn a little bit more about your background and how you got started in research.
Well, I'm from Ecuador, so I went to med school at Ecuador and not researched there. But then I applied to the United States for the neurology residency. Doing research is very important, you know. Sometimes it's difficult, and you know, I took some courses, but still, you know the material, but you don't know where to publish. And luckily, Cureus is very straightforward. You know, it's basically a kid could use the software of Cureus. It's very easy to use here.
It is easy.
I'm not saying it's easy to publish there, but it's easy to put your paper on the platform. I match into Michigan State University Spectrum Health 3 months ago, so I'm doing my neurology residency at the moment. And doing research definitely puts you above in the list when they are doing the interviews and deciding things.
That's absolutely true. So one of your papers, it's a review paper on the alien limb phenomenon in Creutzfeldt-Jakob syndrome or disease.
Yes.
From what I understand, it's a very rare but lethal neurodegenerative disease. So what kind of stemmed your interest in that?
Well, Creutzfeldt-Jakob is, like you say, it's a very fatal disease. Interesting. But what is even more interesting is the alien limb phenomenon, you know? I saw it at first in Dr. House in one episode.
Oh, really?
And then, believe it or not, I see it on my grandmother had that.
Oh my gosh.
The symptom, yeah. But it was transient, but she definitely had it.
And what was it from?
Sorry?
What was it? What did it stem from? Did she have an underlying condition?
Yeah, so there's three causes for alien limb mainly. Yeah, the most common, is a stroke.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's what people doesn't know, because it's more commonly tested in when you're taking an exam or something. It's associated with corticobasal degeneration, which is a movement disorder disease. The second disease that is associated is this one, Creutzfeldt-Jakob, but my grandmother had a transient ischemic attack, which means a small stroke in the brain. She developed this syndrome where basically your hand detached from you. The hand basically do that and you say, hey, are you doing this? No, it's acting on their own.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Are you familiar with the author Oliver Sacks?
Of course.
Yeah.
So anyone school of neurology.
Right, I would think so. I think I first read about alien limb syndrome in The Man Who Mistook His Wife for a Hat. I mean, there's some crazy documents that he's written.
Yes. People might be familiar more with the movie Awakenings.
That's right. Yeah, Awakenings.
With Robbie Williams. Yeah,
right. Yeah.
A must watch for every neurologist.
Absolutely.
It's a true story.
Yeah, that's right. Wow. Cool. So I'd love it if you could kind of just walk us through that review article and tell us a little bit more about it.
Yes, of course. So basically you have Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, right? So let's start by saying, what is Creutzfeldt-Jakob? It's a rapidly progressive dementia. You have a patient who start forgetting things. And you say this must be Alzheimer's, you know? But the progression is so fast that make you think this might be an infection, such as encephalitis. But everything come back negative. And after doing a lumbar puncture that is positive for the 433 protein, you realize, oh my God, it's Creutzfeldt-Jakob.
Wow.
Yes. Sometimes it happens just by bad luck, you know, it's on the genes.
Right.
Believe it or not, if you eat, there's a variant called Kudu where you eat brains from the cow and you can develop that.
Oh my gosh.
Because cows can have Creutzfeldt-Jakob, the disease on the brain. So if you eat the brain of those cows, you get Kudu.
Fascinating.
Yes. In Yes. In fact, there's a story in New Guinea of cannibalism and all that tribe got Creutzfeldt-Jakob, mad cow disease. Maybe you have heard that term, mad cow disease.
Oh, of course. Yeah, I've heard that. Is that actually the same? Oh, I didn't know it was the same. Fascinating. Okay.
Yes. There's variants of Creutzfeldt-Jakob. You have something also called fatal hyperinsomnia, where basically you're unable to sleep and you die because you need to sleep for be able to live. Horrible way to die, yeah, but if you ask me. Yeah. But going back to Creutzfeldt-Jakob, they, besides the dementia, they start having seizures, myoclonus. A myoclonus is something like this, you know? Mm-hmm. The seizures, of course, and from time to time, they start developing the alien limb syndrome. So basically the review is to see how many patients with Creutzfeldt-Jakob have alien limb syndrome or alien limb phenomenon.
Right.
And also what variant, because there's three types of alien limb phenomenon. I don't know if you want to know the three variants.
Tell us the three variants.
It's very, very, very interesting, I promise you. So this is the variants of the alien limb. So by definition, the alien limb is your limb that could be just your hand or could be your whole arm, even your leg, but that's more rare. It start to acting on their own, you know? It start to grabbing your phone. It could be just elevated. And that has a phenotype. And the first phenotype is the anterior phenotype. And the one that you see on Dr. House.
Right.
So this is the alien phenotype. So grasping behavior. So here's my phone and out of nowhere, I start to reach out, grasping. And it's not my intention to grasp, is the alien limb who is doing. The second part of the anterior phenotype is the hand-hand interference. For example, I'm talking with my phone and my hand just take away my phone. It's interfering with the activities of this hand. I'm brushing my hair and the hand just interferes. That's the hand-hand interference.
Wow.
Yes. Also known as a disconnection syndrome because it's disconnected your arm from you. And what is more interesting is that you are unaware of this. How can you be unaware of that? Right. But most patients are mainly unaware of that. Then you have your callosal variant. The callosal variant is for the corpus callosum, okay? And basically you just have the hand-hand interference. You don't have the grasping behavior.
Interesting.
And the posterior phenotype is the milder one. It's hard to distinguish because basically your hand is just levitating out of nowhere.
And the posterior one, you said that is the most typical one to be seen with Creutzfeldt-Jakob, is that right?
Yes, that's the most, but I mean, it won't worry you that much that your arm is like this, you know? I mean, that's not that bad, right?
I guess not.
Yes, and you having some clonus like this, But it's basically levitation of your arm. That is, and you usually also have sensory symptoms. You say it feels weird or something. You actually acknowledge this. As opposed to the anterior phenotype, you actually acknowledge that you have, hey, my arm is levitating on their own. But at the same time, those patients have so many problems that people might think that they're just getting crazy because they're getting crazy very quickly.
Right. Quick side question. Phantom limb, different from alien limb, correct?
Oh, yes. So the phantom limb is basically just having pain where you are not supposed to have pain because you don't have the lymph anymore. So you see that in amputations and it's very, very painful.
Yeah.
But it's because your brain got confused. And when the brain got confused, it irritates, it's painful.
Yeah, my grandfather had a wooden leg and he would get phantom limb syndrome. So we'd love to ask you some more personal questions about you as a researcher and we'd love to know what your advice would be for up and coming researchers.
Oh, yes, of course. So I love neurology. So it's easy for me to write, you know. Right now, I tell you very passionate about the alien limb. I don't know if you could feel it.
I could.
Yes, so that's the secret. If you like something, you're passionate about it. You want to know more, right?
Absolutely.
And I was very lucky to do some rotations everywhere. Miami, Chicago, New York, Peoria. I was in 8 different hospitals, and I actually was very lucky to see a patient with alien limb. Phenomenon. So when you have a lot of experience in different places, it helped you, because every hospital is different. Every hospital has their own thing, you know. For example, in the Bronx, there were a lot of gunshots to the head because the Bronx is dangerous. In Norwell, in Manhattan, there were a lot of fancy diseases that you don't see anywhere. So I know it's difficult to go to a lot of different places, but the more experienced you are and the more places you try, that's going to broaden your neurology cases, and that might inspire you to do your papers, you know? But basically passion.
I love that. And what skills would you say are essential for a researcher?
Oh, you have to be very passionate, you know, first. Second, you have to write well. You have to be a good leader, because it's difficult to write by yourself 14 pages, right?
Right.
You need to be friendly. It's difficult to manage 14 people, or 10, or 5, or 6, who knows?
Sure.
But you need to be a good team leader, you know? I like to be with 10 people. It's usually med students. Mm-hmm. Because if you tell a med student from Ecuador, hey, let's do a paper, they go crazy. They say yes right away, you know?
Right.
Because it's not very common to publish in Ecuador, so.
Well, we're trying to change publishing, as you know, and make
yes,
it accessible
of course.
To the world. Yes.
Mm-hmm. So we say passionate, we say a good leader. And you need a goal, okay? Because if you have a goal, you know where to go. So my goal was to do residency in the United States, have an impressive application. So with my passion and good leadership skills and my goal, when you see where you want to go, you might go there. So I think that was the thing that got me to publish 40 papers. Because I did it gladly and happy, you know?
Right. I mean, I think you've published over 30 papers in Cureus, because you've been co-author on some too, right?
Yes, but all are my ideas, let me promise you that, you know.
There you go.
But sometimes, you know, you have to tell the other author, okay, help me, and you are the first author, things like that, you know.
Right.
You need to compromise. Some people like to be always the first author. You need to compromise in order for the paper to be finished.
So, what's your most favorite paper that you've written so far?
The last one.
The last one?
Yeah.
Is it always the last one?
No, it's because the woman I like is in that paper and she helped me.
Oh, that's very sweet.
So when I published that paper, this girl Gabby got really, really, really happy. Uh-huh. So watching her smile about publishing, you know, nothing beats that, you know.
Uh-huh. Wow, it's a curious love story.
Curious love story. Oh yes, I like her a lot. Yeah.
Great. And then lastly, do you have someone who influenced you, or like a role model that you looked up to, who want to share?
Well, of course, my two heroes are Oliver Sacks and Dr. House.
There you go. Already discussed.
Yes, of course. So that's someone that I was seeing who did research, not in Ecuador, you know.
Right.
I mean, actually, there was a guy in Ecuador who had like 15 publications, And I thought, if he can, I can, you know?
Mm-hmm. Right. That's great.
Yes, and I think I Googled and somebody recommended Cureus once, and the rest is history.
Nice. Mm-hmm. So do you have any papers that you're working on currently? Anything you want to share?
Oh, yes. I'm working on NDI encephalitis, another very interesting disease, you know? People usually present as bipolar patients, psychiatric issues. These patients go to the psychiatrist and the psychiatrist. In the end, it's just encephalitis. And you only find out that it's NDI encephalitis when they start developing seizures or the level of consciousness decrease. And there's a particular pattern that you see with these seizures called the Delta Brush. So it's a meta-analysis about basically how many Delta Brush you see when these people have seizures.
Fascinating.
Yes.
It's so nice talking to you. Thank you for doing this with us, and thank you for being our first participant. And when we're calling this Curious Conversations.
It's an honor to be with you guys, and please send my best to Dr. Adler.